BioBalance HealthCast episode 214, Cholesterol, Fats, and Protein.
BioBalance HealthCast features conversations about positive aging. Your hosts are Dr. Kathy Maupin, Medical Director of BioBalance Health and a leading expert in treating symptoms of aging, and Brett Newcomb, a licensed professional counselor.
Welcome to the BioBalance HealthCast. I'm here with Brett Newcomb. I'm Dr. Kathy Maupin, and we're going to talk today about cholesterol, fats. We're going to talk about what my patients ask me, because many of them say, oh, my doctor said you don't need to know about my cholesterol because you're just doing my hormones. And why do you want to know about cholesterol? Tell me about that. So basically, the subject of our discussion today is the significance of looking at lipids and how lipids go from when you eat something that has fat in it or cholesterol in it, and how does that get to your cell so that it can be used. So there's a big process in terms of getting your lipids out of your food, making them dissolve in your blood, and then taking them to the cell so that they can work. And yes, you do need fat in your diet, and yes, you do need cholesterol. And yes, cholesterol can be too low because we need it for many functions in our body.
Well, there are different types of cholesterol.
That's true, but if you drop one with a cholesterol medication, you drop them all.
Right.
So we need cholesterol, and yes, cholesterol can be too low.
So there are sort of two brackets to the conversation that your patients bring to you. One bracket is, explain to me this terminology and these ingredients and why they matter if I'm here for hormones. And the other is your ability to show them or talk to them about how the system works. In many ways, I often reason by analogy, where you use facts. And the analogy that I would use is that your bloodstream is like a superhighway, and that there are trucks and cars and buses and things zooming up and down the superhighway 24/7, even when you're sound asleep, and they're all like delivery trucks. And they're going to a particular location, and they're offloading whatever they've brought to deliver, mm-hmm. and then they're zooming back to the warehouse to get some more. Mm-hmm. Sometimes there are traffic jams. Sometimes mm-hmm. the bridge is out, and nobody can get through.
That's true.
And part of what makes those traffic jams and makes the bridge fall in is a disruption in the transport and distribution process mm-hmm. of the lipids and the fats and the carbohydrates that are critical for cell survival.
Right. So the reason we eat is really not because eating's fun, but it is.
Yeah. That's a secondary reinforcement.
That's a secondary thing that makes us eat, is because it feels good to eat. But the primary reason we eat is for energy. It mm-hmm. is a matter of taking in the proper foods that feed your body properly.
So the ingredients that we need to take in are carbohydrates,
Fats.
And proteins.
Mm-hmm.
And the bloodstream carries all of them, but they are not all dissolvable into the bloodstream. They don't just subsume themselves in the blood and go to their location.
If you've ever put fat on top of water, if you've ever put some drops of oil on water, you see that it just beads up, and it isn't dissolved in water.
Right.
So blood is basically water, and proteins within the water. So fat has to be carried in a truck to your cells.
Right.
And the truck basically is glyco, or a sugar, a carbohydrate,
right.
that attaches to the fat that makes it soluble in your blood.
It's like these things you see at on the train, and the truck backs up and takes the case off of the train and then delivers it.
It's a carrier.
and you get off the superhighway and you get on the back road down by the sacroiliac, going to this one little location to drop off what's critical for that location. And in the meantime, the cops, the white blood cells that are screaming off to get to your infection, and the adrenals that are saying, oh, holy cow, that man ran a red light, you know, are passing around you.
It all works.
And you still
got to
get there. It's
so
fascinating.
When a patient's talking to me about why these lipids, and I think I just misspoke, it is lipoproteins. I'm sorry, it's not glycoproteins. It's lipoproteins.
For the fats
mm-hmm. that are carried. So, but when my patients ask me about cholesterol is the primary ingredient in testosterone, estrogen, cortisol, all of the steroid hormones.
The building block.
That's what it's made of.
Yeah.
That's like the flour in the cake. basically, if you don't have flour, you don't have a cake. Or you could have non-wheat flour, but it's still flour. So you have to have that to actually make your hormones. Mm-hmm. So it's vital that we have cholesterol. So when I look at cholesterol with my patients, I say, okay, one aspect of cholesterol is cholesterol that may be too high.
Right.
And that cholesterol, if the types of cholesterol in your
the LDL,
cholesterol,
the HDL.
The LDL is the bad one. HDL is the good one. So basically, HDL protects us. LDL can cause atherosclerosis or plaque. So that makes it the bad one. We look at both the total amount and we look at the distribution of lipids. So that comes from your food. But interestingly enough, it has to go through your liver. It doesn't just come directly from your food. It goes through your liver and then is made into cholesterol. Mm-hmm. So the liver is the processing plant. And then the cholesterol gets hooked up with a protein and carried into your blood. So I always look at the physiology.
Right.
How does this work on the cellular level? So then I can back up and say, what's wrong with what is going on with my patient?
Right.
So if one of the key things is I look at cholesterol, because if there's not enough, you can't make testosterone. You can't make estrogen. You can't repair your cell walls. You can't repair your brain. I mean, our brain's mostly cholesterol. Did you know that? I mean,
so cholesterol is
important.
The ingredient that the cells use to make the membrane that keep them solid.
Right. That holds them in.
If you don't have the cholesterol, then the cell will dissipate and all the ingredients in it will dissolve into the body.
That's right. You won't heal, or you'll have fragile cell walls, mm-hmm. like what you talked about. So it's not about how low can we go with cholesterol. It's about how we can put it in the optimal level.
Right.
And one of the ways I do that, one of the controls, it's not just what you eat. It's not just your genetics. It's not just your liver that impacts this, but it is your testosterone level. Mm-hmm. If your testosterone level drops, then your liver goes, uh-oh, not enough cholesterol. There's a feedback system. So you make more and more cholesterol trying to make more testosterone.
So the cholesterol is a biomarker that tells it, oh, get busy, go to work.
Mm-hmm.
But it's also its own functioning reality.
Yes.
Okay, so yes. It's a dual
It does
purpose.
Lots of things.
Yeah.
And it's also a structural kind of component.
Mm-hmm.
So biomarker and also it signals.
Right.
That there's not enough cholesterol, because obviously you're not making enough testosterone. So I often see someone's cholesterol go up. They say, oh, my cholesterol went up. I went on Lipitor. My cholesterol went down. I was starting to feel bad when my cholesterol went up and getting the symptoms of low testosterone. Then I went on Lipitor and they got worse. Well, that's because then you didn't even have, your drop so low, you don't have enough lipoprotein and less enough cholesterol to make your testosterone. The small,
right.
meager amount you are making goes down.
Right.
So it's important to me in replacing hormones and keeping my patients optimal, healthy, not developing plaque, for me to look at how this all works in that one patient that's sitting in front of me. So I want to look at how much cholesterol do you have, what drugs are you on, and how are they transported?
Part of the reason we're having this conversation, you started today by saying your patients actually come in and ask you mm-hmm. these questions. Why are you asking this? Why do you need to know?
Mm-hmm.
We are doing a series of conversations that are subsequent to our having read this book called mm-hmm. The Disease Delusion by Dr. Jeffrey Bland. And Dr. Bland's argument in the book is that the focus of medicine is at an evolutionary turning point, where it used to be focused on look at the symptom and treat the specific piece that's broken and make sure that it's okay. Like if you've had a heart attack, let's make sure your heart is safe and functional.
Mm-hmm.
And so they laser focus or micro focus on what they need to know for that. Dr. Bland said we are now at a place where we can and we should evolve away from just doing that to looking more globally, more systemically, at how all the pieces interact with each other, and that you can avoid heart attacks as triage crisis situations if you go back up the food chain far enough that you can balance the testosterone, balance the cholesterol, balance the protein input, diet, exercise. All of these pieces need to be looked at together. And that is what you are
doing.
That's
what I've always done. So when I read his book, I'm going, yeah, that's what I do.
What he said.
You know, this is what I tell my patients.
Right.
The difference that makes it very valuable for you.
But the heart doctors are still saying she doesn't need to know anything about your cholesterol level.
I know. I get the most criticism from the cardiologist. They're like, why is she looking at your lipids?
Yes.
She
don't do that.
She doesn't do the heart part. Well, yeah, I do. Yeah. When I replace testosterone, oftentimes the LDL will come down and the total cholesterol will come down because of that feedback system. And then when I change diet, triglycerides have to do with sugars, not with fats. So then the triglycerides come down. And that decreases your risk of heart disease.
Well, and part of Dr. Bland's argument in his book is that some physicians are so specialized and so hyper-focused and passionate about what they do that they tend to ignore or dismiss information from other physicians and other ways of looking at it. Matter of fact, you were telling me that someone you know just went to a heart doctor to have something checked, and their immediate response was, you should never be on ADD medicine.
Right.
And they don't know why they're on ADD medicine. They don't know what medicine they're on. They don't know how often they take. I mean, he hadn't bothered to
do anything. He knows what he's on.
You shouldn't be on it.
But he says that causes instant death.
Yeah.
Okay, well, there's
millions of people out there that are
on ADD medicine, and that's not what we can't. I mean, then tell me how this works, basically.
Right. Yes.
And tell me why this is so, and why in this particular patient you would say that.
Right.
When they've been on it for 20 years.
Right.
Why would we now stop it?
Or as Monty Python says, "I'm not dead yet."
That's true. I mean, oftentimes
bring
it's like
bring out your dead.
The thing is that ADD medicine is now being used to stimulate neurotransmitters in people who have been overstressed their whole lives.
Right.
I mean, I'm contrasting this cardiologist saying you shouldn't be taking this, and then going on. And then I ask why, and he looks at me. He didn't even look at me. I mean, you know, he goes, you shouldn't be taking it. You know, that kind of thing.
Yeah.
But I'm going backwards and saying, you know, ADD medicine, when you've helps your brain, when you've run out of neurotransmitters, it rests your brain. It lets you recoup your norepinephrine. It lets you recoup your dopamine. It
allows you to focus.
It allows you to focus and function in life. And so some people actually need that so they don't fall asleep on, you know, for narcolepsy,
right.
Same medicine,
right.
Don't fall asleep on the way home and get in a car accident and kill yourself. I mean, that's kind of critical. That'll get you faster than a heart attack. And then you also have to be on it for some people to do their job, to be employed. That's important. I mean, some people have to be on it because otherwise they're so spaced out, they can't even talk to their spouse. They're just kind of everywhere,
mm-hmm.
Minute by minute, changing
squirrel
subjects. Yeah. So it is a quality of life issue, and it is not given lightly. And the psychiatrists that do this and the family doctors that do it
know the patient, know the life circumstances, and know if it's a long-term trauma history that their zero has reset. If you're interested in this topic, if you go back and look at our last podcast, we talked in more detail about how systems reset and how you have what's called sensory adaptation. So if you live under a given stress load for an extended period of time, your alert cues will reset to require a higher level of volume to get your attention.
Mm-hmm.
And if you've always lived that way, then your whole system is monitored for that level of stimulation.
Mm-hmm.
And if you want to change it, you have to do it incrementally over time with re-education.
But as
and
we get older, that
management
level of adaptation,
yeah,
we can't adapt as well as we used to.
Right, because we don't have our hormones.
So, right, we don't have our hormones.
Going back to the systemic.
That helps. That does help, but it isn't always everything. You sometimes need a little help too.
Yes.
Sometimes you've run out of gas. Your brain has run out of dopamine and norepinephrine, so you do need the medication. Coming back to lipids transport, so my patients basically say, why is LDL dangerous?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Well, LDL is low density lipoprotein, lipofat protein, and It's dangerous because it's low density, it's small, and it can actually make plaque more readily than HDL. HDL is big and it can't really get in to the cell to make the plaque. So if you have a lot of cholesterol that's HDL, then that's good. It keeps you from getting plaque. It's running around carrying your lipids, but it's not becoming plaque. It's not getting into the cell and causing plaque.
And plaque builds up inside the blood cell, bloodstream, so that the opening for the blood to flow through gets narrower and narrower.
It's like corrosion on the inside of your blood vessels.
Right.
It destroys the wall.
And the heart has to pump harder to push or even maintain your systolic and diastolic. It keeps a higher pressure load.
Because you can't dilate.
Right.
It causes your vessels not to dilate like they should. Like if you're exercising, you should dilate your blood vessels, your arteries. But if you have a lot of plaque on your vessels, they don't dilate. So they can't bring more blood flow to the tissues. So that's the basis of why atherosclerosis is so bad. Your vessels get stiff. And then they also will let little bits of plaque come off, like the corrosion flows out, and that's the bridges out. It stops up the blood vessel.
Yeah. So
this is
so you have a blood clot.
LDL, well, it's kind of a blood clot, but we call it a heart attack. It's really a fat clot.
A fat clot.
And the fat goes in and just plugs up the vessels.
Mm-hmm.
So basically, it's important to watch LDL. It's important to watch certain types of LDL. And it's important to have a good HDL. And so testosterone helps the LDL go down, helps the total cholesterol go down, and estrogen in women help the HDL go up. In men, it doesn't help HDL go up.
Right.
So in men, we usually give fish oil and some other essential nutrients that we don't get in our diet enough. And that helps us build our HDL to protect us.
Mm-hmm.
The big pieces of fat that aren't causing plaque, but protect us from plaque.
Right, and provide the energy that the cells need to do their jobs.
Right. So it's important to me for my patients because I'm not just looking at hormones. I'm looking at health. I'm looking at, it doesn't do me any good to replace somebody's hormones if they're going to have a heart attack because I didn't look at their lipids and no one else is.
I don't mind telling people that I am one of your patients. And when I first came to you, I had been on blood pressure medicines monitoring the cholesterol issue for over 20 years. And I had low testosterone, and I had the blood pressure issues, and I was flirting with diabetes.
And you were on cholesterol medicine.
And I was on cholesterol medicine. So after a year and a half of harassing me about my diet, my exercise, my weight, and replacing my testosterone, I was able to come off of every single one of those.
I didn't harass you. Oh, yeah, maybe I did. I'd like you to live a long time so that we can continue to
we may have different definitions of harassment.
Okay. I reminded him.
But you also co-opted my wife, and so the two of you were harming.
Yep.
But at any rate, my point is all of those things in tandem cleared up my blood vessels. I don't have a cholesterol problem. I don't have a blood pressure problem. I don't have a triglyceride problem, and I'm not on any of those medicines that I was
diabetic.
On for 25 years. And I'm not diabetic.
Because that was like something we were waiting to happen. The next step was going to be diabetes. If you keep ignoring that, that's what happens.
Right. And all my family has had chronic histories with all of those issues. It's a genetic and lifestyle problem for our family.
But it's not like I just put a magic wand over him and it happened.
She harassed me for 2 years.
No. Your wife makes the best food, and it is low sugar and low carb, which is what you need to watch. Not, some people need to watch fats. You need to watch carbs. So for you, it's the perfect diet, and she's followed that. And then you work out, or you exercise every day.
Dark green leafy vegetables. You have to retrain yourself.
Yeah, and honestly, it makes you feel so much better when you eat properly.
It does.
And it makes you feel terrible if you stray and eat something that other people think is, this is so awesome. It's like, it doesn't taste good anymore.
And if her husband, who's an attorney, were here, he would require us to say, you may not get the same results. Everybody is different.
That's true. That's true.
And that is true.
So everybody's genetics is a little different, and yours was perfect, plus your persistence. Once you were going, you saw results, and you kept going, and that's really important.
That's self-reinforcing.
So But it's not the cholesterol in your diet. Interestingly enough, which they've told us for all these years, you can't eat meat, you can't eat eggs. Well, they've repealed the Egg Act, which in terms of cholesterol, I mean, eggs are the perfect food. The lecithin in the white balances the cholesterol in the yellow. And if I was on a desert island and I had one food, only one food, it would be eggs.
What?
Because everything you need to live is in the egg. Everything that makes a chicken, which is, you know, just a bird, but it has everything, every nutrient in that egg.
They're like little baby life pills.
They are. And so every day you should be eating at least one boiled egg. I mean, it's the grease and basted and fried eggs that are a problem, but not the egg itself. So that's not what causes your cholesterol to go up. That gives you, it balances the lecithin in the white and the cholesterol in the yellow balance each other, and they are the perfect food. So you don't have to limit that. I don't, you know.
You make milkshakes or smoothies at home. You could pop a raw egg in those.
Yeah, you can, as long as you know that they don't have salmonella in them.
Right.
You know that you've washed the egg carefully and that the shell is safe.
Yeah.
You don't want to take an egg out of the nest and pop it into your, and not cook it. So it's important to wash the eggs before you eat anything that's raw. Because that's where the salmonella is, by the way. It's on the outside. So that's important. But in any case, I guess what I want to stress is, as a physician, we are in the backs of our minds while we're talking to you. If we do holistic kind of preventive medicine and try to make you healthier, in the back of our minds, we're thinking of all of these different transport processes and what we can do to detour things so you don't get a disease.
Right.
What are the interventions that we can use to detour
first,
from
first
a disease?
First, do no harm. Don't make it worse.
Right.
Secondly, make improvements.
That's right. And so if you don't have enough proteins, you can't carry your lipids.
Right.
So people who don't eat enough protein, and see, I'm an advocate of eating meat, so
well,
that would be me.
How do vegans get fat in their diet?
They eat beans, but that there's not much fat in that.
Right.
And
so there
ongoing
concern with a true vegan diet.
Yeah, some people do well on it, but honestly, we're carnivores.
They do well
we
if
need
they have
protein.
Supplements.
Yeah, they have to have a lot of supplements. And,
right. And
we are carnivores. We're kind of built that way. There are certain things we can't make.
Well, now, my wife tells
bodies.
Me when she gives me a salad, we are omnivores.
Well, that's true. We are omnivores.
So.
But we have part of us that has to have essential nutrients, essential proteins that were from animals. Now, having said that, some people don't do well with meats or milk products, one or the other or both.
Right.
And in those people, they have to take supplements that give them essential nutrients. And I know that that's possible. However, more of the people that I've seen go on vegan diets, not all of them, I have a few exceptions, gain weight because they eat so many carbohydrates. And that's our next issue.
Absolutely. But carbs are an issue for me,
mm-hmm.
but I still have to have some.
Yes.
It's a question of which ones and how much.
That's right. That's
right. So it's all about the balance. Find a physician that is aware of the concepts, at least, if not the book, that Dr. Brand has written called The Disease Delusion, and that is focused on knowing you, your history, your lifestyle, your issues, and looking at a balanced approach to treatment.
Make sure you don't have to know all this. This is not your job to know everything, but
right.
all my patients are curious, and it's important that you at least get some of the concept. You can read the book so that you understand what's in the brain of your holistic doctor who is trying to help you be healthy the rest of your life. Honestly, we're not trying to make you live to 115. That's not the goal. The goal is to be healthy until the end of your life and to be vibrant and to be on our own.
Well, if you do live to be 115, we want you to be alert and alive and cogent and active and happy.
And that's our goal. So we think you should understand some of the things we think about. You don't have to commit them to memory. But you can always rewatch it.
That's why it's out there.
Yeah, that's right. So it's one of those things that I think you should be aware of what we're thinking about and why we do some of the tests we do as preventive medicine doctors or anti-aging doctors, because we really are concerned about the whole body and not just your hormones.
Once again, thank you for listening.
Email your questions or comments to podcast@biobalancehealth.com. You can find the BioBalance HealthCast on iTunes and on YouTube. For more information about bioidentical hormone pellet therapy and other reverse aging solutions, visit biobalancehealth.com or call 314-993-0963. You can find Dr. Maupin on Twitter at Dr. Kathy Maupin and on Facebook at facebook.com/biobalancehealth. Find Brett Newcomb at brettnewcomb.com.